Well, I was giving the topic, what does Africa expect from us? Of course, a very big and wide topic. I will start with this slide, which was Newsweek publication on how to heal the world, with this Ghanaian woman and a child. And I think this actually gives us some more information and also some hints about what's happening on the continent. What does Africa expect from us? Well, of course, in terms of cardiovascular healthcare, that we need more capacity building and also the capacity for treating the cardiovascular diseases and the commitments and the responsibilities for this task that we, the African physicians in diaspora, should take also the task, the commitments and responsibilities to tackle these problems. Of course, the policymakers and also the international community. We started a medical surgical missions in 2004 with a colleague in South Africa, Cape Town, Dr. Kuhn. After supporting him, helping him to establish a ventricle assist device program at the Christian Barnard Memorial Hospital for heart transplantation, specifically only for bridge to transplant, because that's the project they needed. And then we discussed why not try to organize training program for physicians in sub-Saharan Africa, and then try to engage them in the cardiovascular disease management and also surgery. So that's how we started with a continuing educational program, seminars. That was 2004 and 2005 in Cape Town. And then we moved to Ghana, 2006 and 2007, also the similar seminars there. And then 2008 and 2009. And even in Ghana, 2007, because of the lack of attendance, the attendance was very poor, so we decided to initiate telemedicine program forum in addition, so that we can have more audience from other regions of Africa. I was very lucky that the World Bank could actually provide me with their video facility facilities in sub-Saharan Africa, about 12 regions. So we could use this to actually transfer knowledge to other regions in Africa. And after Ghana, we had also meetings in Kampala, Uganda. And then 2012, we had a meeting in conjunction with the World Health Summit here in Berlin. And 2013, I was invited to Rwanda by the government within the framework of Ghana, German African Development Program, to advise the government on how to organize their cardiovascular program. So far, we have had about 1,500 participants in our continuing educational program. And you can see these are some of the pictures which I'm showing you. Our first telemedicine program with the University of Erlangen, Professor Viant, where we transmitted live surgery from Erlangen to the other regions of Africa so that we could interact and discuss during our seminar. And we did similar program also in Tanzania with the telemedicine forum. And this is what we are trying to contribute towards development of cardiovascular medicine and surgery in Africa. These are the networking of the video teleconference in Africa provided by the World Bank. And we had similar program. We expanded this program, this telemedicine program, into an intercontinental telemedicine forum last year, where also we had a program on cardiovascular surgery in the tropics or in the developing countries. So these are the programs we are using, and China, India, Africa, and South of America presented cases in this forum. This is the World Health Summit, which is held annually here in Berlin every year. The founding president is Professor Ganten, the former CEO of Charité. And this program is being patronized by Angela Merkel, Holland, President of France, François Hollande, and the Mr. Barroso from the European Union. This is the telemedicine forum we had last year, you could see with China, India, and this, it was a very interactive, very viable discussion on cardiothoracic surgery and medicine in Africa. We invited many African colleagues, especially from Nigeria, who have some problems with capacity in cardiothoracic surgery, with over 170 million population. According to my studies I performed last year and 2 years ago, there was no functioning cardiac unit in Nigeria with 170, which is very serious and pathetic. One of my programs also is in China, where within the German-Chinese senior expert service, where I also visit these regions to also extend our transfer of knowledge and know-how. Now, the challenges of cardiovascular healthcare in Africa, whether it's myths, realities, or opportunities, these are what we have to discuss and to answer. The capacity building, as always I've said, is a very important issue. Continuing education, transfer of know-how, and especially partnership for mutual cooperation. It's a very, very vital issue which could lead us to cooperate, to collaborate with institutions from abroad and at home. And finally, if things work well, of course, science and research will be another problem. But at interim, with the problem of the lack of capacity in Africa, there should be de novo programs. That's the visiting heart teams have to be motivated, encouraged to be there with or without governmental funding. The world population is 7 billion, and Africa is now up to 1.1 billion. And sub-Saharan Africa is 874 million to date. And 43% of the population are under 15 years, which is about 375 million. And even in 2050, the population of Africa is going to double to 2.2 billion. So this is a real challenge for the future in terms of cardiovascular health care and the changing of lifestyle on the continent. These are the countries with whom I organize cardiac surgery capacity in Africa, East Africa, the Horn, the Eritrea, and Ethiopia. And I thank Dr. Andreas Urban, who was very, very supportive with his team, Dr. Cho also, and others from Italy and Switzerland. Central Africa, Angola took part. We also included North Africa, but it's going to not be the issue, as more or less as a control group for us to know what they are doing and what Sub-Saharan has to do. And in the Southern Africa, we got Mozambique, and Namibia, and Tanzania, who also took place in the study. And in West Africa, Côte d'Ivoire, Ghana, and Senegal. In our study, we realized that if you take the percentage population of sub-Saharan countries on the 15 years with 36.5%. Kenya with 41.6 million, we have our 42% of the population on the 15 years, and that is 17.5 million. And they have 11 pediatric cardiologists, which makes a ratio of 1 to 1.6 million. Rwanda, two pediatric cardiologists with a ratio of 1.2 million population. Eritrea, one cardiologist, which is a ratio of 1 to 2.3 million. And Ghana, two pediatric cardiologists, 1 to 4.6. So you can see that 16 pediatric cardiologists in these countries serve about 33.8 million people, that is under 15 years. What about the cardiac surgeons? Our study showed clearly that only 57 cardiac surgeons who are doing open heart surgery in sub-Saharan Africa, which means a ratio of 1 to 14 million per million population. There are 22 cardiac centers, which makes one center to 37.4 million. Five are in West Africa, one in Central Africa, 12 in East Africa, and two in the Horn, and two in the Southern Africa. If I say Southern Africa, that doesn't mean South Africa, but the Southern African states. So there is a big difference. Let's take, for example, Ghana, the healthcare in Ghana, Africa. A population of 25 million. The greater Accra, the capital, has 4 million population. And they have registered cardiac surgeons, six. And of these, two are visiting surgeons. So that we have a ratio 1.1 to 4.2 million people, or without the surgeons, with the visiting surgeons, and then 1 to 3 million people, that is, with the visiting surgeons. The further, this is a big problem. The great concern is Nigeria, with a population of 168 million, almost 170. They have about seven major hospitals who were doing cardiac surgery, but totally collapsed. Nothing is happening. So that in 2012, there was not a single open heart surgery done in Nigeria. That's our great concern. Out of the 57 cardiac surgeons in the sub-Saharan, 56% are locals, and 43 or 44% are foreign surgeons who come on missions. From the regions where cardiac surgery is practiced, from the 57 surgeons, you can see that in West Africa we have 12 cardiac surgeons there, 10 are locals, and two are foreign teams. Central Africa, we have no local cardiac surgeon, only visiting surgeons. In the Horn, we have six foreign surgeons, five in the Eritrea and one in Ethiopia. In the East Africa, we have 29 cardiac surgeons, and of these, 19 are locals. Whereas South Africa, we have six cardiac surgeons. If I'm in terms of Mozambique and Namibia, there are six, and out of these, one local, and then five visiting surgeons. What about pediatric centers or surgeons? In East Africa, they have pediatric cardiac surgery in Mombasa, Nairobi, in Kenya, and in Rwanda, in Kigali. In the Horn, in Asmara. In West Africa, we have two centers, but only one center does actively pediatric cardiac surgery, that's in Kumasi. And in Southern Africa, in Mozambique, which was initiated by Magdi Yacoub many years ago, and in Namibia, also a local cardiac surgeon. Distribution of the pediatric cardiologists in the region is also very important, so that they can take care of children from the north, east, west, other countries. You can see that Kenya has better distribution of pediatric cardiologists in the regions. So at least four regions are being well served, whilst in Ghana we have only two, one in the southern, the capital, and one in Kumasi. And that's also a very great concern. Now let's come to the global under five mortality. 6.6 million children under age five died 2012, and nearly 18,000 every day, 750 children per minute, and 125 per second. Globally, under five mortality now is decreasing, which is a very important sign, very good sign. And the causes of child mortality are pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria, were accounted for about one third of the under fives. Then comes congenital heart disease, and as well as rheumatic heart disease. In sub-Saharan Africa, it's almost the same. Under five have these problems. And then between ages 5 and 60, also HIV comes into great, tuberculosis, maternal mortality, rheumatic disease, and congenital heart disease. Now, I want to show you this slide because this is a development which happened in the United States and is going to happen in England, and this is also going to happen in Africa or in other countries. You can see that the infant mortality resulting from congenital heart disease is 48% on the 1 year. Most of non-Hispanic blacks. And when they survive the childhood into the adulthood, it's also about 76% of them ever die. The studies in England and Wales also show similar, that's about 22%, 60% of the children under 1 year died in 1959 to 1963, some years back. And it came up to 22% in 2004 and 2008 study. So this process, this development is also going to happen in Norway, also in our continent. So we have to actually prepare for these changes. Now, budget. The healthcare expenditure, if you take the 2% of the GDP, that's the gross domestic product, it's only 6.4, and now 6.3 in sub-Saharan Africa. Even the private 1%, the private sector is only 3.5% of the GDP. The health expenditure per capita, 2010, which was published in 2012, is only $84. So how could we do heart surgery with these figures? That's what I wanted just to show you. If you take countries like Ghana, $77, Ethiopia, $42, Eritrea, $16. So these are the figures we have to know to see how we can tackle the problem, because the government per se can't actually do nothing. And about 40 to 50% of the national budget of the sub-Saharan African countries are being subsidized by the Western countries. See, so that even they can't do any high-tech medicine with this money. These are the challenges we are facing in the management. This is the living conditions. The parents have to also do nursing care in the hospitals. He's also, we can have a police force in the hospitals who control the rats around the hospitals. Now the high-tech devices. Now you see the room for the supplies almost empty. And if you are going to surgery, you have a surgical fee collector just in front of the operating room. If you don't pay, you don't enter the operating room. The means of payment, if you don't have money, probably you can use, you can give the doctor either a chicken or a goat, you know, as a subsidy. Well, at the same time, we have areas and regions where we have high-tech intensive care and well-tech, like Ghana, Kenya, and other countries. We did a study some years ago about the prevalence of cardiovascular disease in West Africa, and it shows clearly that prevalence of cardiovascular disease is 2.5 per 1,000, and most of them are congenital heart diseases, followed by rheumatic heart disease. And the patterns of the congenital heart disease is almost similar also to Europe and other parts of the countries. VSDs, fellows, ASDs, pulmonary stenosis, PAD, TAG, these are the patterns that you also encounter in these regions. And if you come to the further, the prevalence of congenital heart disease who are severe and needed cardiac surgery, the rate is about 2.5 to 3 per 1,000 live births. So it's enormous. With that, we calculated that in sub-Saharan Africa, estimated 1.7 to 2.7 million children will require cardiac surgery. Has the sub-Saharan Africa the capacity to face this challenge? There are other challenges across sickle cell disease. You can have this problem also in a heart patient, a child who has malaria and all this. So it's going to be sometimes a challenge to the visiting teams, a triple burden for a child for congenital and rheumatic heart disease, especially in the Central and West Africa, where sickle cell disease are more prevalent. Thus, the prevalence in the global distribution of sickle cell, where West Africa especially and the Central Africa are more prevalent. Prevalence of rheumatic heart disease, I won't go into further because we all know that most of them are in Africa and other regions. 1% of school children suffer from rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease. Of course, due to development and World Health Organization programs and so forth, there's now an age shift, even the sub-Saharan African, now about 22 years, formerly about 14 years. So that there is a change in the transition where the people grow older before they come for surgical treatment and so forth. Now comes the diagnostic. If you don't have echocardiographic machines, your diagnosis is, of course, not very perfect. There's a study done in Cambodia and Mozambique. You see definitely that the clinical diagnosis of prevalence of rheumatic heart disease was 2.2 per 1,000. But using echocardiography studies, it was 21.5 per 1,000. So it is very, very important to have these our colleagues, our physicians, training program on echocardiography so that we can do better. So these are the high-tech demand for cardiovascular surgery. The infrastructure should be there. Of course, the setup cost is high. The general perception that cardiac surgery is inherent too expensive and not a priority. Human resources and capital resources are intensive. There's a lack of commitment also to infrastructure development and ability to maintain financially solvent programs. What happens, those who have money, the rich people, they will send their patients or their children to foreign countries for surgery. Therefore, it's going to be a capital flight for internal healthcare investments. The Sub-Saharan Nations Alliance spend almost about estimated 5 to 10 million a year on sending their citizens to Europe, India, and US to receive healthcare. So that's our current model now, which being actually followed by many cardiac teams who come to Africa, to invite foreign car teams to work at local hospitals as a training concept, send physicians to centers in emerging economies and developed countries for postgraduate training and post-mission task force for post-operative care. So this is a team from Boston and our team who were in Ghana 3 years ago. This is our team who went in Ghana. We have in US about 9 teams who come to Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, every year. In Europe, about 16, including Belgium, France, Germany, about 3 teams, Italy, Portugal, Sweden, Switzerland, and UK. Israel, 1 team comes to Tanzania, Australia to Rwanda, and New Zealand also to Rwanda. Now, I would like to comment on this problems concerning the visiting teams and the development of post-operative care in cardiovascular disease. You can see that, for example, the Kenyatta National Hospital in Kenya, they did 2006 and 2010, 407 cases. Mitral valve replacement. Most of them were mitral valve replacement, 53% of their cases. Repair was only 28. And congenital heart surgery was only 8, that's about 2%. 2%. If you compare then the East African activities of visiting teams, the Horn, that's Eritrea, did about 503 cases between 2002 and 2012. They did the most, more or less, surgical intervention in this region. And then East Africa, also the British, the UK team, they did about 294, about 29 open heart surgery a year, which is, of course, nothing, but it's something which could help some other children. And in the other regions, West Africa have the same pattern of surgical and clinical pattern of congenital heart disease. Very interesting is the input of the missions who come to Africa. If you take the East Africa region, about 65% of the cardiac operations were performed by foreign missions, only 34% by the locals. So that you see the discrepancy in the capacity problems. And West Africa is different, about 95% of their cases were done by the locals and only 4% by the foreign countries. And the same, similar to Southern Africa, were 46% by the foreign missions. Well, this shows us clearly, also in Central Africa was totally done by missions from outside their country. And this shows us the capacity problems existing in the sub-Saharan Africa. If you compare the whole Africa or sub-Saharan capacity so far as performance of the cardiac centers are concerned, with a population of 9.8 million, excluding Egypt and South Africa, as well as Sudan, so you see that 11,302 open heart surgery were done in 2012 and 2011. With a ratio of 12 open heart surgery per million. If you compare Germany, it's 1,000 per million. China is 158 open heart surgery per million. And India is 100 open heart surgery per million. In Beijing, I won't go into details because we have our Chinese colleague. Probably I can just say this information we had during the last October in telemedicine forum, which also shows clearly that the China with 1.3 billion has 158 open heart surgery per million. And in Beijing, they have 20 million population. Of course, it's a mixed population, so it's difficult to assess, but they have 1,377 open heart surgery per million. So because most of the heart surgery is done in Beijing. And how to measure the performance of the missions or the performance of cardiac surgery is very important. Castaneda, Aldo Castaneda made a very interesting measurement using the standardized mortality ratio, as well as also the risk-adjusted congenital heart surgery to actually measure our performance, the performance of the surgery, which is all very important for the locals and also for the missions, so that they know what they are doing. And this will bring up some more aptitude, as well as also responsibility to the local trained people, and see how they can adjust themselves also to the teams. There is always a learning curve, but if you take a training program with the locals, you might see that in a certain situation, the beginning is also just the missions who are performing the surgery, and later on the locals will come in, you have to mix them together, so it's going to be a mixed team, and that's where you see a learning curve, higher mortality, which goes down after some time. So these are developments one also has to face. Of course, the missions would like to have the best results, but it cannot always work. They have to mix them together some time after training program so that they can also be independent and work themselves. The comments made by Marco Tirina about missions, that's probably very important. Short missions of mercy by foreign teams are good for publicity, but have a negative impact on local teams, who have to struggle after departure of prominent teams with local inadequacies. Well, there are some truth in them, but still one has to solve such a problem. But I believe that the teams also have to provide extra group of missions so that they can stay 1 to 2 weeks after their mission so that they can take care of the patient for a time, and then see how they can incorporate a telemedicine program in addition, so they have a constant touch and networking with the locals to see what they are doing. Well, Mother Teresa said beautifully that we ourselves feel that what we are doing is just a drop in the ocean, but the ocean should be less because of that missing drop. So we have to encourage the missionaries, the visiting teams to do it. I motivate them. I'm very, very happy that they come to Sub-Saharan Africa to do this wonderful work. So we motivate them, help them in any way they need. And I think my association organization, Africa Cultural Institute, is always there to help any mission who needs help, politically or also sometimes financially.
Dr. Yanka, we are running short of time.
Yes. So I'll conclude now. What does Africa expect from us? I think we need different points. The continuing educational program in Germany is very important. The invitation to language symposium should be extended to many Africans. And when they come here, accommodation can be provided, and they also use this for monthly teleconference case presentations. And we have also fellowship programs which are going to be organized and established. 6 months for pediatric cardiology, as well as 12 months training in pediatric cardiac surgery. And we have centers actually who are going to help in this program, the Deutsches Head Centrum, Deutsches Kinderhead Centrum in St. Augustine, and then the cardiology department in Erlangen. So we are grateful for this help and this support, and we hope we can help our countries. And we have also another program, that is telemedicine or telecardiology program, which we are going to start very soon with our colleagues in Berlin who are practicing the private practice. And this monitor, this echocardiography machine is already in Ghana. So we are hoping to start also a training program for nurses and for other healthcare personnel so that we can improve our diagnostics. So I would like to thank you for the attention. Thank you.